Question, totally unrelated by the way, but you ever wonder what animal was the first time we've ever seen a dwarf in nature? Well, you're looking at him. This isn't editing, this isn't Photoshop, this is a...
Oh no! Oh no, I'm so evil! I'm so evil! I'm sorry, I did not mean to laugh at that!
How's it going, folks? Jack here with another reaction to check out some more from Casual Geographics, who's blessed us with a new video that is sounding quite intriguing. This is called Don't Watch This Video If You're Afraid to Smile. So we could call these a Try Not to Smile or a Cry. The devil is in the details. I'm back with my cat who is licking me. Do you mind not doing that? And well, yeah, let's just jump straight into it. Oh God. No! Oh yeah, this we've seen before with the sea animals.
Yeah, this about is... that. So I've been making content for almost 4 years now, and in that time, I put therapists in Bentleys and more people on couches in the housing crisis of 08. Probably an exaggeration, but you get the point. I've ruined more animals for people than the fans of Zootopia. So because of that, and because this video is 2 years old now, I thought it'd be fun to remake it. So, same rules apply. I challenge you to watch this video with a straight face. If you smile, you lose, and because I'm that confident, comment where in the video you folded. Because I got an ace in the hole, and I don't mean Austin. There's one surefire-
Okay. Game face. We're ready. I'm an individual who smiles way too much. I'm very happy. But let's tap into our darker side and try to maintain the mask. See, I'm already smiling. It's weird.
Far away to make the terminally online smile.
Oh yeah.
Look.
The over-exaggerating mothers.
Yeah, that'd do it. Now for a while, I wasn't a believer. I thought cats pretending
parents,
to be scared by
dads,
their coats was one
as
of those
well.
Feel-good facts we made up. Like the idea that the four-letter C word that elephants think of when they see us is cute. The problem with that theory is we've seen lions, tigers, leopards, and snow leopards all do this, so there's only two options. Either the most overqualified killing machines on Earth also have the awareness of a kumquat, or cat moms actually play scared to boost their child's confidence.
Yeah,
likely to encourage
big cats.
The type to stalk, hunt, and all the things he'll need to get his own groceries one day. But the underrated part is, they don't just act, they overreact the way any parent supporting their child would. I've seen leopards get DoorDash delivered to the dome and not jump as high. The things mothers do for love.
Yeah.
What about fathers? There is no child support in the wild, and nothing stopping most males from going out for milk indefinitely, but there are some exceptions, like Murphy. Murphy is a 31-year-old bald eagle living in the World Bird Sanctuary in Missouri, where
okay.
The symbol of America is expected to spend the rest of his life after an injury left him unable to fly. He'd also probably never have a mate since he was never able to bond with any of the females.
Oh.
For a minute, it seemed Murphy's Law had our boy in a chokehold, but one day last spring, keepers noticed Murphy acting weird, or at least weird for a grounded avian incel. They took a closer look and realized Murphy had built
He was taking care of the egg.
He had a rock that he made his full-time job protecting from not just people, but the other eagles too.
Bruh.
Somebody on the Discord did post something about the different identification for cats that one can have. Like a cross for Murphy's cat. Any box that can contain a cat will contain a cat. But Murphy's eagle is a new one to me. Imagine if this thing just was... released from captivity and landed somewhere like in Plymouth Rock. Wow, the symbolism.
Two, scientists believe that spring hormonal changes had triggered a paternal response in Murphy. In other words, that baby fever had him acting different. But the story didn't end there. A couple weeks later, several miles away, an eagle nest had fallen during a bad storm. And one thing about eagle nests, they're much bigger than you think.
Mm-hmm.
The fall killed one of the eagle chicks and left the other one an orphan. And that's how Murphy got promoted from a rock to a real-life baby. Keepers introduced him with a little eaglet in a safety cage in case Murphy switched up and chose violence. He chose quite the opposite. He showed genuine curiosity in the orphan and eventually started feeding it completely on his own. And just like that, first-time father Murphy took the chick under his semi-crippled wing and the two bonded. Bro manifested fatherhood. And only a couple months later, Eaglet 23-126 was released back into the wild after being successfully raised by Murphy. And while it's technically bad luck to name a bird meant to be released, Murphy's son still managed to leave with a nickname, Rocky. Speaking of the rock that started it all, Murphy's rock child would be auctioned off with the proceeds going to the sanctuary's food bill. As for Murphy...
Fuck me, man. How can you withstand smiling from these things? It's genuine great behavior displayed by animals. That's the thing that I will always mention to people. Like, I have a thing about where from we derive our morality. Because I'm very much of a humanist. And one of the few things that I came to learn was, despite us as being the species that we became and evolved to, and having access to this wider range of the emotional spectrum, animals can also have access to that, especially to the notion of empathy. And this is something that we observe in dogs, of course, great apes, minor apes, if you want to call them that. Birds also do have that, and of course felines. It's beautiful to see these stories like that.
Murphy, I'm sure he's enjoying the empty nest, at least until next spring, where he'll probably do it all over
again.
Yeah,
I'm failing this challenge.
Speaking of bodyguards for birds, next we got to talk about the Maremma. This cotton-colored canine was bred in the mountains
sheep
of Italy by farmers to protect their livestock from anything from packs of wolves or bears to even white-tailed sea eagles.
So, quick little anecdote. My beautiful cat here, this Russian Blue, is sleeping. It's one amongst few animals that I've gotten the chance to take care of over the last few years. And coincidentally enough, a lot of them have been blue for some reason. Like, we've taken care of some French bulldogs that also had that blue fur. But that's not the point. My point was that my girlfriend really does not like animals with like pointy ears, with the exception of some of these dogs, even the French bulldogs, but they're more rounded in their ears. But if we ever were to get any, it would be like to have like those flappy ears, and these guys were some of the desired ones, and they are so cute. Like, we visited a shelter some time ago to see some animals, and they are extremely cute.
But they don't just look like sheep. Maremma puppies are often raised alongside sheep with very little human contact, leading to an overprotective Q-tip that views the entire flock as its family.
They blend in.
Don't get me wrong, Maremmas have the personality of a cinnamon roll most of the time, until you give Dog Toretto a reason. So in this case, if you flock around, you will find out.
Family.
That doesn't just go for sheep. On the complete opposite side of the world, on Middle Island off the coast of Australia, the world's smallest penguin was flirting with extinction. The little blue penguin nearly got wiped out of existence by foxes.
Another blue animal. Funny.
So bad that the population that was once at 20,000 got cut down to 27.
Oh.
That's when a farmer had an idea. Swampy Marsh already had Maremma dogs guarding his free-range chickens, and you know what they say, penguins are just business chickens in suits. So he had two of his dogs, Yudi and Tula, raised around penguins. How'd they get their name? That's how.
Right.
And just like that, the two dogs would see all penguins as their own, and as you can guess, they defended them like it. The Maremmas didn't even have to put foxes on shirts. Just having their scent around was enough to make a fox readjust its grocery list. And it wasn't long until the pint-sized penguin population made a comeback. The two dogs that pioneered this have since retired, but to this day, you'll still see Maremmas running protection for the little blue penguins of Middle Island. We really don't deserve dogs. Even in one of the darkest days in American history, you'll find at least one dog trying to make it better. You don't need a history lesson to grasp just how horrific the 9/11 attacks were. It was rough on everybody, including the rescue dogs. But you ever wonder what happened to the four-legged heroes of Ground Zero?
Okay, I'm not sure that I'm ready to hear about this. And I'm saying this because back in 2015-14, Sue, my ex-girlfriend's dad, who I'm still very good friends with because he's a gamer, introduced me to The Daily Show with Jon Stewart. And that's basically the first time that I actually got to watch that. And through this introduction, I got to learn about Stewart's engagement in helping the first-time responder that were there during the September 11 attack and were helping people. But these people, of course, suffered a lot of health issues and were completely disregarded by the US state. And so there were a lot of cases, a lot of fighting in courts, and some of it resulted in some good, and still the compensation has not been given to these people. So my whole point with this is that through what these people have gone through, I just can't imagine what the dogs have gone through. Hopefully these puppies were treated right, in the least.
Well, this is Brittany. She's a golden retriever with a name that would give autocorrect an aneurysm. She was also the last surviving rescue dog from 9/11. Ground Zero was actually her first ever job with owner and trainer Denise Carlos, where they spent 10 days at the disaster site. Brittany would also go on to help with searches after Hurricane Katrina and her equally evil twin sister Rita. Brittany would retire at the old age of 9, but wouldn't retire from making a difference, just this time in schools. She would go on to work in elementary schools as a reading dog. She was basically emotional support for first graders or special needs children struggling with reading, and with Brittany on the clock, those same children actually performed better. But like honestly most good things in the world, Brittany was unfortunately taken from us in 2016. But not before getting a hero send-off from firefighters and rescue workers on her way to the animal hospital where she was retired from life. Brittany retired from helping people, but the next animal needed people to help her retire.
Okay, that was that's cheating. I was expecting something that would have made me mad, but he went for the tears. A good tearjerker, thank you. Wow. Yo, when you saddle to Papa, that's been serving for 9 years, at least to the age of 9. Whew. What a cool gal. Oh no. What's wrong with it?
So this bear went viral because, let's be honest, if you've worked more than a minute or gone to college at some point, you've been this bear. But her backstory was less relatable and a whole lot less wholesome. This is Chada, and for the first 14 years of her life, she was part of the Ukrainian circus, where she was exploited, tortured, and treated as a prop. Things didn't get much better when she was bought out of the circus because her new home would be a small rusted cage above a garage that would be cruel for a bulldog, let alone a whole bear. The abuse left her virtually blind and even cost her most of her teeth. Worst of all, Chada is a Himalayan brown bear, an endangered species with only hundreds left in circulation. So long story short, it was all bad for Chada. At least until 2019, when the beaten down bear was rescued and taken to the White Rock Sanctuary in Ukraine. So if she looks like the wrong side of the weekend, it's because she just woke up from a 20 year nightmare. That might actually be the first time she's ever touched grass in her 25 laps around the sun. But what does a bear that spent 5 presidential terms in a box even do for fun? Well, if you ever see her, she's probably playing in her pool, or making friends with a stick, as one does. Or she's channeling her inner old head and yelling at the bears and wolves for making too much noise. And even though she's 25 and allegedly too old for DiCaprio, Chada's even been seen spitting game, kissing one of the other males in the sanctuary through a fence. A whole girl still got it, and I'd 100% commit a senseless subtraction for Chada. But
I was not expecting the DiCaprio joke there. Exquisite, mate. Exquisite.
I would commit crimes against humanity and an affront to the Lord for our next animal. Question, totally unrelated by the way, but you ever wonder what animal was the first time we've ever seen a dwarf in nature? Well, you're looking at him. This isn't editing, this isn't Photoshop, this is a...
Oh no! Oh no, I'm so evil. I'm so evil. I'm sorry, I did not mean to laugh at that. Oh fuck. I've never seen a dwarf elephant in my life. I've seen a lot of elephants, but never seen a dwarf elephant. Yo, nature was out here giving people elephantitis. Elephantitis. That's the right way of pronouncing it, of saying it. And then got tired and were like, yo, we gotta hit you with the video. Oh boy, I'm going straight to hell.
An elephant just over 5 feet tall. I don't think y'all are really hearing me. I can look this elephant in the eye! Got a little out of character there, but yeah, not only did biologists in Sri Lanka find this DeVito-built elephant, yes! They really found man's trying to square up with another male. Not to mention the steed of Tyrion Lannister was actually the aggressor. Little guy wanted every ounce of the smoke. Turns out being built like an aggressive footstool makes it really awkward to fight you. And I like to think all the elephants treated him no differently, because even elephants understand. Sometimes shit happens. My only question is, with dating, right? You think you can reach? I feel like it would take creativity, the Kama Sutra, and a Pilates class for a female to make it work. I don't know where he is or what he's doing, but if I ever see bro in a Kevin Hart movie, then I can sleep well knowing he's found his purpose.
But, yo, if I could give him a virtual high five right now, yo, dude, I would. That we are on the freaking same wavelengths here.
But if there's one animal that needs a movie, it's one that got violated in one of the biggest box office come-ups of all time. I love Lion King, and Simba's revenge arc altered my brain chemistry for the better. But they'll forever catch smoke for having all the homies hating hyenas. In real life, lions steal from the laugh track of the savannah more than vice versa. And sometimes lions take more than just lunch. Generational beef is so on site that lions will go out of their way to blow a hyena's back out and retire both of their back legs. They don't even kill them, they just nerf their quality of life and let time do the rest. And that's exactly what happened here, where this hyena was filmed after a lion left him operating on less than 50%.
Oh, no.
But apparently last Sunday wasn't the first time a lion couldn't kill a 49er, because that same hyena was found almost a year later, still paralyzed, but still very much alive.
That is impressive. This sweet lass here once took a jump because we live in like two stories, and she such an idiot. She likes to do a lot of acrobatics and occasionally loses balance, and so instead of actually setting off in the right place, she decided to jump into the open wide and landed wrongly and injured her foot. That had her nearly bedridden for like 3 or 4 days. She refused to walk. At least she did attempt, but that didn't really help. I was carrying her around all the time. Perhaps that's the reason why she's always clinging to me. I don't know. Perhaps. The thing is, this is bloody impressive. Keeping going after all that crippling injury. Well, don't have humans to take care of them though, so what are they to do?
Now, I couldn't really find a lot of info on him, so that's all we really know. Or at least it would be, if I didn't reach out to the guy that took the video. This is Kathan Moore. He's a wildlife photographer who was kind enough to give me the full story, or at least from what he saw. So here's the full timeline of the hyena that ghosted death, straight from the source. He first saw the handicapped hyena January 8th, 2022 in Kruger National Park in South Africa. He was impressed, but also bittersweet, since there was no way he would survive the African bush with a broken back. Except Moore would see the same hyena again in April, same disability, but otherwise still healthy. But the real plot twist wasn't until he saw him around other hyenas. Kathan watched as the two-wheel drive ran over to a kill and started shoving hyenas out of the way, even snapping at one from behind.
What?
The disabled hyena was still bullying other hyenas in the clan and earning his pound of flesh, and Kathan even believes that he was one of the higher ranking members.
Yo, the hyena was like, I am Ivar the Boneless. Come at me. Yo, that's that Viking spirit.
Kathan would see this middle finger to the Grim Reaper throughout the months before finding him for the last time on the last day of 2022. Almost a full calendar year after seeing him for the first time. According to Moore, he sat with the hyena all day, almost as if he knew. Now, Kathan hasn't seen him since, and while there is a good chance his time finally ran out, Moore also believes that he could have just moved on to another area with his clan. But even the worst case scenario means this dude survived at least a year after getting spine split by a lion. That's a W in and of itself, unless you're a Lions fan. Now, we've talked about some of the weirdest animal team-ups in nature. There's warthogs using mongoose as a spa, a guinea pig doing the same thing except with vultures,
and of
course, the fact that ravens are a step away from fully weaponizing wolves. But there's another animal duo that nobody saw coming, and this one also involves wolves. This is an Ethiopian wolf, and out of the almost 40 species of canines, they're the closest to getting completely discontinued. But they found an unlikely ally. This is a gelada. It's really the hippo of monkeys, because even though their dental screams carnivore, geladas have the diet of a lawnmower. Somehow the wolves figured out that their chances of a successful hunt are higher when they do it around the monkeys. In fact, their success rate went from an anemic 25% when alone, all the way to 67% when surrounded by gelada gang. And somehow the same monkeys that run from the mountains when they see a feral or domestic dog are the very definition of unbothered around the wolves. The wolves even go out of their way to make themselves look like less of a threat, switching out their normal zigzag hunting run for a slower, less intimidating stalk. It's believed the grass-fueled geladas disturb rodents and stuff and make it easier for them to get picked off by the wolves.
Yeah.
And even though the monkeys are about prey size, in about 8 years of research, there was only one time where a wolf tried to murk a baby monkey. The wolf got dealt with violently, and like a predator on a registry, was never allowed near the herd again. So
I'm failing this so hard, but man, those monkeys were like, you've gone to the wrong neighborhood.
Might not be the Disney movie wolves and ravens are, but geladas and wolves might just be the most underrated duos in nature. But you won't find a better story than the tale of the BLT.
Yeah.
The story of a lion, tiger, this. And bear cub all rescued from a basement in Atlanta and brought to the Noah's Ark Sanctuary. The three had bonded and were inseparable, so they were nicknamed BLT. B for Baloo the bear, L for Leo the lion, and T for the tiger named Shere Khan. Baloo was like the chill older brother and the glue of the group. Leo was the quiet, stoic one, and Shere Khan was easily the troublemaker, but by far the most affectionate. The three were basically conjoined triplets for 15 years until Leo would pass away in 2016 to inoperable liver tumors and Shere Khan expired in 2018. I'll drop a link to a video with the full story, but a lot of people wanted to know how Baloo was doing. So I asked them, and here's what they said. The last member of BLT is doing well and actually celebrated his 22nd birthday last July. He hasn't been introduced to other animals since Shere Khan and Leo, but considering black bears are solitary, he's probably happier that way.
I guess.
Best believe the star of Noah's Ark gets spoiled with fruitcakes, ice treats, and even bubble baths. They even went and renovated his old clubhouse because Baloo only deserves the best, and when he's not in there, he's enjoying life in his own private personal pool.
Oh, that's sweet.
Bro living better than me. So how's Baloo doing? He's doing how he deserves. Also, his favorite treats are Tootsie Pops and Oreos. That has nothing to do with anything, I just thought it was cool. Speaking of Oreos, what do a parrot, a raven, a seal, and a beluga all have in common?
Great hearing. Processing information to a certain degree. Speech? No, like, ravens do, parrots do. Belugas can understand human speech. That it.
They've all shown the ability to mimic human speech, from conversing corvids to catcalling seals. But there's another animal not enough people know about, and that would be Wilkie, a 14-year-old
orcas,
and the first one to ever mimic human speech. And before you say it, no, not like this. I think. I hope. You see, orcas aren't just intelligent, they have cultures and different trends that they follow, just like us. They also have different dialects, with each family group having different tones and frequencies. It's like how I can say, Aaron earned an iron urn, but if you in Baltimore, you finna hear, Wilkie was trained to mimic her caretaker, saying things like, hello, bye-bye, and even count to three.
One, two.
Hey, before you judge them, just remember, they're doing that from a nostril on their head. It's all fun and games until you're on a boat and a desaturated serial killer tells you bye-bye. But like with other talking animals, orcas are just- On a boat and a desaturated serial killer tells you bye-bye.
Yo, I see that. I'm never getting onto the ocean again. Waters, no. I straight up start acting like I had rabies. I will be drowning in a cup of water.
Like with other talking animals, orcas are just mimicking the sounds they hear around them. Mimicry is a vital skill for a lot of animals, but it's also led to one of the most iconic animal pictures of all time. You've definitely seen this viral picture, but you probably don't know the tragic chain of events that led to it.
Oh.
The man taking the selfie is Mathieu Chamavu, and the two girls behind him are Dakazi on the left and Ndezi. It was taken in Virunga National Park, home to up to 1,000 endangered mountain gorillas. Here, the biggest threat to a 400-pound pacifist is poachers, either trafficking babies as pets or straight up slaughtering adults to sell as trophies.
What the fuck?
What happened in 2007, with a mother gorilla taking a bullet to the back of the head, execution style. She was long gone by the time rangers got to her, but they found 2-month-old Dakazi still clinging to her life-deprived mother. She was taken in, but it wasn't looking good. She was severely dehydrated after 24 hours without milk, and even developed pneumonia 2 weeks after being brought in. That's when Andre Belma got involved. He was the manager of the orphanage Dakazi was brought to, and he willed the sick baby gorilla back to health. The very first time they met, Andre held the baby against his bare chest for warmth and kept her there all night. Unfortunately, the story would only get worse. Barely a month later, another attack cost the park 5 gorillas, and yet another orphan was brought in, this one named Ndezi. Dakazi and Ndezi were raised together and became not just lifelong friends, but sisters. Not only did Dakazi see her as family, she saw Andre Bauma as a mother. Gender roles be damned. And the feeling was mutual, with Andre seeing the orphans as daughters. Now, raising children's hard enough, and gorillas are no exception, but Andre actually had a secret weapon to keep the girls in line. Pringles. Yeah,
No, seriously?
Now, one thing about gorillas is that babies often learn by imitating the adults around them. And with only humans around, the sisters eventually started seeing the other rangers as role models. One day, a ranger noticed he had two shadows mimicking his every move. So he pulled out his phone, snapped a picture, and that's how the world got blessed with this. Now, unfortunately, in September of 2021, Takazi would pass away at 14 after a long-standing illness, and she spent her last moments in the arms of Andre Bauma. Yeah, aww. The same man that held her that night 14 years ago. So where are they now? And Desi's still alive and well, actually serving as a role model for the younger gorillas in the park the same way her sister did. Mr. Bauma's still out there making a difference any way he can. And Matthew, he clearly hasn't slowed down with the selfies. That's gonna do it for this video. Drink water, hug your parents. Shout out to Lions fans. I know I rag on y'all a lot, but I low-key have respect for you guys, and if it was up to me, y'all would be the ones in the Super Bowl. Shout out to Kathan Moore for helping me with this. Please go check him out and tell him I
will. Oh, those are some nice pictures, man.
See y'all in the next one.
Trolling. Oh man, my heart got struck with all the feels there. This was so touching. You're leaving me to deal with this all my own. Anyways, guys, thank you so much for checking out this video. Let me know which moment in this video was the most touching to you. Personally, I think it was the one with the gorillas there in the end. Perhaps it's just my disposition to thinking that they are perhaps a bit too much like us, and thus they do understand a bit more what loss feel like. I don't know. It just struck me a bit too much, and especially because of the involvement of poachers in this. They're the worst. Fucking worse. Anyways, sorry for the cursing there. Thank you for watching. Of course, please do make sure to go and subscribe to Casual Geographic. And if you like this video, don't forget to hit that like button. And of course, subscribe if you want to see some more. That being said, we should have a wonderful day. See you guys in the next one. Bye.